Did I record this?
This is a wonderful cultural place we have going on here. They have dancing, they have swing dancing and tango dancing. They have all kinds of dancing, as well as poetry and organic food. It's an awesome place to be. So we're happy to be here tonight. I would like to welcome you all to our second annual student showcase. All right, so real quickly, I would like to announce a couple of things. The first thing is just make sure your phone's on quiet so that in the middle of people trying to perform, there's not phones ringing.
Yeah, and that wouldn't be very nice.
It'd be kind of mean. We prefer that you not be getting food when there are performers dancing, just in case. We never know when, like, feet might fly up and kick you as you're trying to get some salad, so. All right. Anyway, my name is Tiffany Wine, and, yes.
Yep, Tiff. That was weak, people.
Jobs, yes. So I just wanted to introduce myself to you guys and kind of what we're doing here tonight. I myself was once, and still am, a dance student. As such, I know how terrifying and how fun and exciting it can be to learn how to dance. About 10 years ago, I saw my first ever swing dance performance. It was a performance by the Rhythm Hotshots. They were a group out of Sweden. This is like before Denver even hardly knew what Lindy Hop was. We were all swing babies back then. And so it was so exciting and so inspiring that I immediately came home and started up my own swing dance troupe called 23 Skidoo. Yeah, and so the reason why I started the student showcase here tonight that you guys are all at was specifically because when people are working towards a performance and have that goal, totally helps them learn to dance and improves their dancing skill very quickly. They advance very fast. And then watching them perform is really inspiring to other people who are learning how to dance or decide they want to after they watch them. So there's this cool symbiotic thing that happens with swing dance performances where everybody kind of gets something cool out of it. So I decided to put together the Colorado Swing Dance Student Showcase. And that's what you guys are here for.
So as you guys all know, I'm Alan. And I'm a lover of swing and jazz and, of course, very fine facial hair. And I don't know if you all know, but along with swing dancing, facial hair has had a very interesting and distinguished role in our nation's history. As the neck beards and mutton chops of the late 19th century gave way to the mustaches and more subtle sideburns of the early 20th century, that had a very profound effect on world events. Although a lot of people believe that the absolute failure of the League of Nations was the biggest blow to Woodrow Wilson's presidency, modern facial hair...
Alan, what are you talking about? This is a swing show. It's about dancing. No, not facial hair.
Sorry.
Good lord.
Yeah, so, okay. I can do this. Okay, so...
Stay on topic. I know you're nervous.
All right. So everybody, thanks for coming out tonight and to be excited about all the performances you're about to see. Tonight we've assembled the best instructors of vintage vernacular swing dancers, and so I'd like to begin the evening by introducing all of our instructors.
Yes!
These are people who have dedicated their lives to the preservation and continuation of these genuinely American swing dances. The Lindy Hop itself has been officially titled the American Dance, and swing is the only partner dance to be made on American soil by Americans. And sadly, for 40 years, this dance was extinct in our country. And so it's with a great sense of pleasure.
Boo!
Just boo me, Tiff. Thanks.
No, that wasn't for you. It's okay. You're still talking about swing dancing instead of facial hair. We're good.
Okay. And so it's with a great sense of accomplishment and happiness that we are here to perform these dances for all of you.
Yes. Let's have all of our teachers come on.
Teachers.
So I'd like to start off by introducing the both beautiful and talented Heather Ballou. Heather is a registered shortened and competed with the Denver Championship Green Swing Group 23 Skidoo. She has taught at many national and international events, and her biggest achievement to date is organizing and growing a very nice troupe of dancers here in town, and she is recognized with creating the Denver Balboa Scene. From Denver to LA to Seoul, Joe Demers is known for his performance Lindy Hop, aerial, and of course blues dancing. He has toured the world teaching and performing these dances. He is also the proud owner of Overstreet Dance Gallery in Littleton, which is a very fantastic place. In 2008, he was awarded the Spirit of Lindy Hop Award at Camp Jitterbug, and he also coaches the Denver-based troupe, the Woodside Jumpers, who will be performing here tonight. Thank you, Heather and Joe! Next. Up next, we have Maya Klosterman dancing with fellow Shaggy Man, John Dyer. Give it up for the Whiskers! Maya is a co-leader and choreographer for the group UNC Happy Feet. She first learned the triple step 2.5 years ago and has been trucking along ever since. She enjoys competing at national workshops and is currently part of local Denver group, the Denver Swing Project. Alongside Maya is co-leader and choreographer John Dyer, also of UNC Happy Feet, who began running Lindy Hop in Charleston at UNC Swing Club. Since then, his dancing has skyrocketed with many performances and contest wins. John loves learning and has made it his goal never to stop. Swing it out, Shaggy Man! Let's have some swing outs! Or not.
Yeah!
And finally, I'd like to introduce Tiffany Wine and Seth Stiefel. Sadly, neither of these two have mustaches right now. I don't really know what's going on. Tiffany has been Lindy Hopping and swing dancing here in Denver, here at the Mercury Café, mustacheless, for nearly 14 years. She has placed in numerous competitions and taught Lindy Hop throughout the country. She is also a member of the Lindy Hop Hall of Fame at the National Jitterbug Championships. And her biggest work is known as a choreographer for the Denver-based group 23 Skidoo. Alongside her is her partner in crime and partner in teaching, Seth Stiefel. Seth has been dancing his long and hip and has one of the original members of 23 Skidoo. His biggest achievement to date was winning the 23 Skidoo Mustache Contest in 2006. Everyone get a load of this stack! Okay! So today, I would like to honor Seth for that achievement with the Walrus Mustache Award on this commemorative plaque. So, jump and hold this for Seth right now. And, Seth, to remind you of those glory days, we have brought a mustache for your enjoyment this evening. Blow that mustache, ladies and gentlemen. And, you know, Seth is also placed in a bunch of competitions and events and enjoys teaching and stuff. I don't know, not really important. So, let's please have a strong round of applause for Denver's finest instructors. Give it up for them. Thank you, instructor. Oh, you gotta leave that on, Seth. You gotta leave that on.
I didn't take into account that I would be out of breath this morning. All right, so to get our show started, we're going to tell you guys a little bit about the birth and swing of jazz. We want to tell some of the old-time stories that helped to get us really inspired to learn this dance. So the birth of swing really starts with the beginning of jazz music in America. Jazz originated at the beginning of the 20th century in African-American communities in the South. It was born out of the combination of European and African musical traditions. And just like its musical counterpart, the swing dances were also born in African-American neighborhoods. And just like jazz music, the swing dances were also formed out of a combination of European and African rhythm and movement. Now, imagine a time, you guys, when electricity was fairly new, so the nightlife was like brand new, you know, and television hadn't been invented yet. So, and the only music that you've heard your whole life consists of march music, maybe some classical, and folk songs. So, now imagine you're walking down the street and you hear someone playing early ragtime jazz. You know, it had an amazing effect on people. And this music was made for dancing. So, such a new and exciting sound, and it became the drive and motivation behind the biggest surge of new dances and dance crazes that Americans had ever seen. Suddenly, Americans had rhythm, nightlife, and jazz.
And let's not forget killer goatees and probably a lot of mustaches as well.
There were a lot of mustaches, but quiet, Alan, quiet. All right.
So during this time, there were thousands of dance crazes sweeping the nation. And one of these crazes became a very important dance that would eventually evolve into Lindy Hop and the rest of the swing dances we do today. That craze was the Charleston. And it was also the biggest craze of the dance, the jazz era. It became known the world over and was associated with flappers, mobsters of the Prohibition era. So everyone, I'd like to present our first student showcase of the evening, a solo Charleston and early jazz era piece, choreographed, of course, by Seth Steeple and Tiffany Wan. Start moving to their feet to that music, and they do it over and over again, someone else picks it up, and they finally make something that feels good and sticks. And so that's what has really happened with swing music. And this is also exactly what was happening in Harlem, New York, during the Harlem Renaissance of the 1920s. The Charleston, which we just saw, was originally done as a solo, but very slowly started to turn into a new dance called the Breakaway. Seth and Tiff are going to show you exactly what the Breakaway looks like and the evolution from the Charleston into the Breakaway. So come on out, please. And then Seth, you're just looking sexy. Mercury Cafe's very own beginner Lindy Hop students. We're going to show you just how the Lindy Hop is done with a routine choreographed by Tiffany Wine and Seth Mustachio Steeple.
Thank you.
1970s, breakaway was evolving into something new in the ballrooms of Harlem, New York. And one of the best of the early breakaway dancers was a man named Shorty George Snowden. Yeah. Around that time, in 1927, Charles Lindbergh made his famous flight across the Atlantic. And the newspaper headlines read, "Lindy hops the Atlantic." Then, during a dance marathon, a news reporter was watching Shorty George's feet, and afterwards he went up to him and said, "Hey, what are you doing with your feet?" And Shorty replied, "A Lindy hop," thus giving the new dance its name. So tonight, the UNC Happy Feet team, run by the operaman mentioned John Dyer and the lovely Maya, are going to perform a piece that I cannot pronounce, inspired by Lindbergh and Amelia Earhart's determination to accomplish feats of flying never dared before. We'd like to ask all of you to join our nonstop flight with Artie Shaw and his orchestra. Please put your hands together for UNC Happy Feet.
Where this dance comes from and why it is so awesome, of course. Way more awesome than facial hair, for sure. By the 1930s, the Lindy Hop was really happening, and the Savoy Ballroom was the place to do it. So, known as the home of Happy Feet, the Savoy Ballroom is one of the most famous ballrooms to exist in American dance history. It spanned an entire New York City block on Lenox Avenue. Within its walls is where the Lindy Hop evolved. Now, the Savoy was famous for many things. One was its Battle of the Bands. It had a double bandstand inside of it where two bands could play back and forth. And according to the dancers who were there at the time, the best music anyone has ever danced to came from some of these Battles of the Bands. There's a couple of really famous ones. One is Count Basie versus Chick Webb. Some of us have heard those stories from Frankie Manning. And another very famous one was Chick Webb versus Betty Goodman. So another reason why the Savoy was so important to the Lindy Hop was due to its dance contests. The dance contests really helped to push the Lindy Hop along, with dancers polishing their movements and competing to come up with new and exciting steps. Along those lines, the Savoy was also host to the famous Cat's Corner, where the best of the best dancers hung out. Other dancers did not go near the Cat's Corner unless they were asked. You had to be invited. Well, you didn't technically have to be invited, but that's kind of how the social thing went. And so the best dancers hung out there trading moves and showing off for each other. And last but not least, it is important to mention that the Savoy was a place that brought blacks and whites together during a time of segregation. I just want to emphasize at this moment what an important part of our history this dance really is. Not only were all of these people, because before this didn't happen, you understand. Not only were all these people of different races in the same room together, but they were socializing and dancing together. And that's the thing that really happened for the first time ever, is on this public level, thousands of people in this public place, this was going on. Norma Miller, one of the Savoy's dancers who is still alive today, has been quoted. I'm quoting here. She said, "The Savoy opened the doors for all people being together. We were the first people in the world who were integrated. We didn't have segregation at the Savoy." Another original Lindy Hop dancer, who you'll hear about later on, Frankie Manning, once stated that the Savoy patrons were judged by their talent on the dance floor, not the color of their skin. And in Frankie's autobiography, he tells this story. He says, "Not even celebrities received special treatment. For example, one night, someone approached Frankie and his friends and said, 'Hey man, Clark Gable just walked in the house.' And then somebody else said, 'Oh yeah, can he dance?'" Anyway, here in Denver, the Mercury Café has been the place where our Lindy Hop community has practiced, grown, and evolved. Yay. Most of us started right here on this dance floor. And in our world, the Merc is our home of Happy Feet. Its floor has certainly kept rhythm in our feet and music in our soul. And now, I'd like to introduce you guys to the Mercury Cafe's very own intermediate Lindy Hop class. Thank you.
pull down that thong with that dance. Clap your hands.
Ballrooms where swing outs or breakaways were often very difficult or banned by the venue. In Balboa, most of the movement occurs below the knees. However, part of its appeal is the variations of turns and twirls allow the leaders to show off their partner's legs. Show off their partner's legs. An effect that is highlighted when the follow is wearing very twisty skirts and high heels. This dance is all about the legs, ladies and gentlemen, the legs. But of course, rather than trying to describe this dance, we prefer to perform it and let you decide if you like it yourselves. Ballyhoo, Denver's very own Balboa troupe, was first formed just 2 years ago in 2010. Its members have performed at Rocky Mountain Balboa Blowout and have traveled all the way to Minneapolis for the Twin Cities Balboa Festival. This May, Heather Ballou, its founder and leader. Yeah, let's hear it for Heather. One more time. Heather is planning diabolically to start a new Balboa team geared specifically for people who already know how to swing dance but want to learn the Balboa. So tonight, let's please welcome Ballyhoo, who is performing Swinging on the Tea Garden Gate by Jack Teagarden.
Thank you.
And as the dancing changes, or as the music changes, so does the dancing. Toward the end of the big band era, new sounds began to emerge as American music made way for rock and roll. Again, the dance changed and reformed itself into something new during this time. Now, during this era, the Lindy Hop split into two different directions. In one direction, it became West Coast swing, which developed in ballrooms and was adaptable to all kinds of music. So modern day West Coast swing isn't done to swing music anymore. It's done to all kinds of Motown and Britney Spears and hip hop and everything. Huey Lewis in the News. It's a little bit different. Yes. Instead of low athletic fast dancing, West Coast became upright and slower. It became very ballroomized. Along the other branch emerged the jitterbug, also known as East Coast swing, which was done to rock and roll, Elvis Presley and all those guys. It kept the athletic vintage tradition of Lindy Hop, but simplified the steps. So Lindy Hop has a 6-count basic and an 8-count basic. It has 6-count moves and 8-count moves. And what happened was jitterbug simplified it out into Lindy Hop's 6-count basics and movements. It is probably the easiest dance to pick up and enjoy right away. It's very fun. And its easy to do footwork pattern, along with its flashy dips and tricks, makes it a crowd-pleasing dance that is just as fun and easy to watch as it is to do. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome mine and Seth's jitterbug students onto the performance floor.
Oh, God.